Actually, it's the first time I've ever been to this spot.
This spot, yeah, you know, you're usually over there.
Good morning. God bless you. Have a good day.
Thank you. You too. Is this talking about?
Well, it's talking about pride.
Pride?
Yeah, pride in general.
Pride in general?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because a lot of times when people associate pride, they think of LGBTQ community.
Sure. Yeah, a lot of people do. Yeah.
Yeah. And I just wanted to make sure that that's not the message that you're sending, because we have a very big LGBTQ community. And as a Catholic, I don't believe that my God would hate anybody. This is saying that this is a sin.
Pride is a sin. Oh, yes. God
pride
says
is a sin.
Pride is a sin. All forms of pride are sin. Yeah.
Well, the Bible is an interpretive thing. And I believe that God doesn't. I'm sorry, sir. I find this. Someone brought this to me because they were very upset. They were very upset. And this is why.
Why?
People, because why should pride be a horrible thing?
Because God says it is.
Well, God says it is, but that doesn't mean anything.
No, well, it sure does.
It sure does. Yeah, God loves and he's forgiving.
My name's Tony, by the way.
Sabrina, by the way.
Sabrina, nice to meet you. So if I can explain.
Yes, okay. Please do.
The reason God sees pride as a sin is because his son, Jesus Christ, humbled himself to take on human flesh and further humbled himself to die a death he did not deserve on that cross.
Right.
That's why God sees pride as sin, because his son humbled himself. No. There are no proud people in heaven, people who think that they're good, that they earn merit before God, that they can somehow commend themselves to God. All forms of pride is sin in God's eyes.
I just want to make sure you're sending that message, because a lot of people associate this with something else, and I don't want that to get misconstrued, because that is why Catholics are being hated on these days, and I don't appreciate that, because I don't want people in the LGBTQ community to think I hate them because I love God.
Well, it's not hateful to tell people the truth. It's not hateful to warn people about the wrath of God to come. It's not hateful to point people to...
I don't see how them being proud of them loving who they love, how that is a...
Because God has said pride is a sin, and God has determined what true love is.
But by you saying this, by them being proud of who they are,
right? It's sinful.
So I shouldn't be proud of who I am. I shouldn't be proud that I'm a good student. I shouldn't be proud.
No, you shouldn't, because that's not going to commend yourself to God.
Okay.
God sees pride. God sees self-love as sinful.
But pride, this is being associated with...
It should be.
LGBTQ.
Because all forms of pride are sinful.
Okay, as long as you are saying that and you're not associating this with LGBTQ community...
Well, no. LGBT pride is sinful just as every other kind of pride is sinful.
But not just them being those people. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you are not saying that...
Well, all forms of sexual immorality are sinful.
That's a sexual immorality.
Yes,
loving
according to God.
Who they love. God does not say that.
Yes,
God
he
says
does.
To love thy neighbor as you love yourself.
Right, he does.
It does not matter.
No, that's wrong. That's wrong.
I'm sorry. I have never been taught that in my life.
Well, you should have been, because that's the truth.
That
no,
is
it's
a
not.
Human interpretation.
No, it's not. God
loves everybody.
No, that's not true.
God loves everybody.
That's not true, ma'am. The word of, Sabrina, the word of God says that God hates those who shed innocent blood. That God hates those... who shed innocent blood, who have haughty eyes, who have lying tongues. God not only hates sin, but he hates sinful people. That's what makes his love so amazing, that he would allow his son to die for people
hates
he hates. And he also
he
hates the sinner.
He wants people to get rid of sin because he hates sin. He does
All
not
of it.
Hate people who sin.
Right.
He wants people to repent.
He does not
hate you. I just want you to understand that I really don't. I'm okay with you spreading God's love, but do not claim that God hates. Because my God is a loving God and a forgiving
Sabrina,
God.
Sabrina, God is a loving God and God is a forgiving God. But not disassociated with his wrath and his justice and his anger against sin and his anger against sinners. Sabrina, you need to be careful not to be an idolater and create a God in your own imagination to suit yourself. God says the soul that sins shall die. And the only hope for anyone is not their pride, is not their love of self, is not creating a God in their imagination to suit themselves, but turning from their sin and putting their trust in Jesus Christ alone for their salvation. The one who humbled himself, who was sinless, who humbled himself to take on the punishment you and I rightly deserve for our sins against God. And then he forever defeated sin and death when he rose from the grave. So whether that pride is LGBT, whether that pride is in academic accomplishments, whether that pride is in athletic prowess, God, the one who loves himself, is not one who loves God.
I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to just, I want you to know that this campus is filled with that. And by us, I am fully okay with you using your First Amendment right. But as someone who has adapted my way, I still love God regardless. I love him and I know he loves me, and that's the personal connection that we have.
Then you need to adapt to God's ways, not your ways.
I do adapt to God's ways, and my God tells me that I should love everybody.
Yes, I love everybody too.
Regardless.
Yes, love your neighbor. Right, regardless.
What you're spreading hate.
That's a lie. You won't read anything hateful on there.
There's
if you read that,
on
that's
here,
right.
But people can interpret this as hate.
That's irrelevant.
Because do you know what this looks like? You're standing here with a cross and then you're handing out something that says this.
Right, yes.
And society
because I love people.
Society has viewed that as
society,
you're hitting, you
society,
are hitting on gays.
Sabrina, society doesn't determine moral standards. God does.
I know, but I don't but I get wrapped into all those people. All of us do. And I'm a Catholic who loves everybody because that's what God
So why are you judging me as not loving people?
Because you're
Why are you judging me?
I am not judging you.
Because you're not loving me, Sabrina.
I am merely...
You're not loving me, Sabrina.
Because I know people came out here very upset that they were handed this card. So I'm telling you that as a fellow Christian, this is going to upset people.
Sabrina, if you were a fellow Christian, you would love what that says. You would love the proclamation of the gospel, and you would not be standing here fighting on behalf of sin.
I'm not fighting on you. I'm fighting on the fact that
you're fighting
hating.
On. I am not. You're lying, Sabrina. I haven't hated anybody.
This
I haven't hated any.
A message of hate.
That's a lie, Sabrina. That's a lie. That's not true, Sabrina. That's God's word. And if you loved God and if you loved Jesus, you would love his word. But Sabrina, you don't. You've created a God in your imagination to suit yourself. A God that says that God's okay with immorality, that he'll turn a blind eye to the sins we like, and he'll judge the sins
well,
we don't like.
That. I'm just saying, I don't think he hates us.
Well, that's contrary to what the Word of God says. God loves and God hates. And he doesn't save us because we're lovable, Sabrina. He doesn't save people because they're lovable. He saves us because he is love and because he's gracious, and he chose to send his son to die on behalf of those who by faith would receive him as Lord and Savior.
Okay, well, I have to go, but
okay.
I just wanted to say that my God loves everybody.
God bless you. So
my
does
God
mine.
Loves everybody.
God bless you. Have a good day.
You too. Have a good rest of your day.
Turn to Christ and live, Sabrina. Turn to Christ and live while God's giving you time. God bless you, sir. Have a good day. God bless you. Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hi, how are you?
How are you?
Good.
Hey, I'm Tom.
I'm Tony.
Hi, Tony. How are you?
Good.
Good.
I'm doing well.
Good. So, I just want to ask, make sure you're on the sidewalk.
Yes, sir.
The driveway.
Good.
Can I see what you're passing out?
Yeah, absolutely. God bless you. Have a good day. Slow down! Man, they fly down this street.
I know. Hey,
yeah.
Stay on the sidewalk, please. Not in the driveway.
Okay. God bless you. Have a good day. God bless you. Have a good day. Thanks. God bless you. Have a good day. God bless you. Have a good day.
Thanks, you too.
Thank you.
Okay, so Tony, what is your message here?
Just what it says, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that there is forgiveness for sin through faith in Jesus Christ.
Okay. All right. Well, good luck preaching the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
So like I said, if you can make sure you're on the sidewalk and not just... Because we have trucks trying to get in.
Yeah, yeah, I'm being very careful of that. You bet. I appreciate that.
Okay.
All right. God bless you, sir. You have a good day.
Thank you.
All righty. You know what? I actually have one for you in particular. As a retired deputy sheriff myself.
Where were you a sheriff
at? Los Angeles County. Did 20 years with the LA County Sheriff's Department before retiring. And I wrote that for the family.
Very good.
Yeah.
I'm not going to read this now. But
that's okay.
And I'll read it a little later.
Great.
Okay. Are you from here?
Well, I live in Davenport now.
Yeah.
Moved out to Davenport to be part of a church a couple of years ago.
Oh, good. What Grace, church are you
Grace at? Fellowship Church in Davenport.
Is that the one way up on...
It's off of West Kimberly, out past Walmart and Harlan's.
Yeah.
You're familiar with the area?
Yeah.
Used to be the old Club Mocan. I think.
Yeah.
It was like it changed hands many times. A restaurant. It was, some kind of club or something. But last was called Club Mocan, and our church purchased that property about two and a half years ago.
Okay. What's it called again?
Grace Fellowship Church.
Grace Fellowship.
Yeah. Mike Reed is the pastor.
Okay. All right. Very good.
All right. Like and, you know, I wear a camera for all kinds of different reasons.
I don't care about the camera.
No. I know you don't. But just for your own edification, if you ever get a complaint of some kind, hey, this guy said this or said that, I am more than happy to show you whatever I got. I'm not out here to cause any trouble. I'm going to obey the law. And
stop
so
preaching the word.
Yeah.
I get it.
Yeah, but I just want you to know that as a Christian and as a retired deputy sheriff, submitting to government authority is biblical.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so I'm here to work with you, not against you.
Okay. So then you know, so as long as you're on the private property, the sidewalk, you're more than welcome to be
sure.
Here.
Yeah, I'm going to stay off the campus. Yeah. I know it's a private school.
So, but like I said, we do have trucks going in and down the driveway.
You
so
bet.
For your safety, if you can just stay on the sidewalk.
Will do.
Appreciate
Will
it.
Do.
Thank
All
you.
Right. God bless you, sir. You have a good day. God bless you. Have a good day.
I already got one.
Okay. Hey, did I give you one already?
You have.
All right. God bless you. Good morning. God bless you. Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you. God bless you. Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you. God bless you. Have a good day.
Thank you, too.
Thanks. God bless you. Have a good day.
What are you handing
out? Gospel tracts. Good news of Jesus Christ.
Oh, okay.
You have a good day, ma'am. God bless you. God bless you. Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you. Okay. God bless you. Have a good day.
What are these?
These are gospel tracts. Good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Okay.
Sure. Cards. I'll talk to whoever would like to talk.
Yeah.
My name's Tony.
Nice to meet you.
And you are?
Rachel.
Rachel and?
Alexa
and?
Kelly.
Kelly, nice to meet all of you.
So what are you doing here today?
Handing out gospel tracts and sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that there is forgiveness for sin.
What is the sin?
Sin is a violation of God's law.
No, yeah, but what sin are you talking about?
Oh, all of them. Any of them. Yeah, and the tract talks
why are you specifically giving out those?
Well, it's just one of many different tracts that I give out, but pride is a sin.
Yeah.
All forms of pride are a sin.
Okay.
And the reason for that is God the Son humbled himself to take on human flesh and then further humbled himself to die a death he did not deserve on a Roman cross. And that's why there are no proud people in heaven, because God humbled himself.
There's lots of proud people in heaven.
There are no proud people in heaven.
Definitely not a sin.
It definitely is a sin.
Being against it is a sin.
Being against pride is a sin? Well, God's word says pride is a sin. And if you'll read that, it explains why. Sure. Yeah. And love, and part of loving people is warning them about the wrath of God to come, warning them about the penalty for sin, all of it, the sins we love to commit and the sins we judgmentally point out in others, that all sin, whether no matter what it is a violation of God's law. And because God is holy, no sinner can be in his presence. That's why we need a savior. That's why we need forgiveness for our sin. And God has provided only one way for that, and that was through the gift of his son, Jesus Christ. 2,000 years ago, God the Father sent his son to earth in the person of Jesus Christ, truly God, truly man, and without sin. He lived a perfect life that none of us can live, because he was God in the flesh. And about 33 years into that earthly existence, he voluntarily went to a cross. He suffered and died a death he did not deserve to take upon himself the punishment we rightly deserve, we should stay. Died a death he did not deserve to take upon himself the punishment we rightly deserve for our sins against God. And then he forever defeated sin and death when he rose from the grave. And that's the good news of the gospel, that no matter what our sin is, if we put our faith and our trust in him alone for our salvation, we'll be reconciled to the God we've lived our life offending. We'll have the assurance of eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ, and our sins will be forgiven.
Also, Jesus teaches everybody to love each other.
And yeah.
Right.
No, he doesn't say accept everything, because God doesn't accept sin. God doesn't accept sin. That's why he sent his son to die. If God accepted sin, he wouldn't send his son to die for sinners like you and me. And all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And one way we sin is pride.
Handing out cards?
Yeah. God bless you. Have a good day.
Thank you very much.
So do you think mocking people is loving? Do you believe that? Do you believe that? God bless you. Have a good day. God bless you. Have a good day.
What can I do?
God bless you. Have a good day.
Hey, you too.
Thanks.
Nice GoPro, by the way.
Thanks.
What kind is that gear for?
Yeah, silver. Yeah. What's your name?
Juan.
Juan, I'm Tony.
Tony, nice to meet you.
Yeah. Do you have any spiritual beliefs, Juan?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? What do you believe?
I believe Jesus.
I'm sorry?
Jesus is the Christ.
Yeah? How did you come to faith in Christ?
When I was younger, I was raised in the church. I was raised in the Catholic church.
Yeah.
But as I grew up, I realized that I felt like I was purposeless. You know, I felt like my life didn't have meaning. But then I realized how we were so influenced by everything around us, especially the music, like hip-hop music. I'm a hip-hop dancer still I dance to more Christian hip-hop, Christian rap.
Yeah.
So I
God bless you. Have a good day.
I know the influence that it can have on a young person, a young mind that hasn't necessarily been exposed to like faith or anything like that. So when I was 19, like God really touched me. And,
yeah, how did that happen?
Well, my mom had moved a few years, not too long before that. So she moved to Mexico and I was like by myself, my two younger sisters. So there was like an overwhelming feeling of, I don't even know like what it would be, but I just felt like I needed something, and I felt so alone at that time, and then I was just praying, and God just came to me and felt overwhelming peace, just His presence, letting me know I wasn't alone.
Yeah.
And then ever since then, I've basically dedicated my life to try to save some people.
So you believe there's any other way of forgiveness of sin but through faith in Jesus Christ?
That's it.
Any good works we have to do to get there by God's grace alone?
Amen.
Amen. So what you're seeing now, of course, is a hatred for Christ and the gospel.
It's just mocking,
yeah.
You know, which I don't think is true. I could,
well, but you know what?
It's gonna be worse.
Jesus said, if they hate you, know that they hated me first.
Yeah. Yeah.
He said, the world will hate you because of me.
Right.
Yeah. They love their sin so much.
And they, sin!
And they hate God so much.
I'm actually a hip-hop dancer, so, you know, like, what he's doing right now is just...
He's goofing off.
Yeah, it's just goofy. Yeah. So, stay encouraged.
I am. And you've encouraged
me. Thank you, man. Thank you.
And your name again is?
Juan.
And yeah, I'm going to try to be out here on Wednesday. Tony.
Tony.
Yeah, what are you studying, Juan?
I actually don't go to school here.
Oh, okay.
I was invited to come and speak to a class.
Oh, yeah, really? What kind of class?
It's for people trying to be teachers.
Oh, okay.
So I'm like, one of the students invited me to come speak to their class.
Oh, great. Great.
I do a lot with anti-bullying in the community. So,
excellent. Great.
She found out about that and she's like, oh, maybe you could come and
nice.
Speak to my class.
Nice. So, great. Well, I hope that goes well for you.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate
all right. God bless you, Juan.
Hey.
I'm going to get back to work.
Hey.
All right. God bless you, man. Thank you. Pray for me, all right?
All right.
Great. Car wants to come through.
Hey, watch out.
God bless you. Have a good day. Okay. Grab my Bible here. Start preaching. I really appreciate you drawing a crowd for me. Thank you.
Hey, you gotta work on your whip, bro.
Well, I want to thank you for coming out. I want to thank this young man for drawing the crowd. I want to share with you today the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
good news of the gospel.
The good news that your sins can be forgiven.
The sins are fantastic.
The good news that you can be reconciled to the God that you've offended by your sin.
Gentlemen.
The good news that you could have the assurance of eternal life. See, each and every one of us, we're created in the image of God. We are all image bearers of our Creator. And as such, God has given each one of us a conscience. He's written His law on our heart. We all know the difference between right and wrong because God has given us that ability.
Praise Satan, ladies and gentlemen.
We know it's wrong to lie because we were created in the image of God. And the God who made us is not a liar like we are.
We are all liars.
We know it's wrong to steal for the same reason, because we were created in the image of God. And the God who made us is not a thief like so many of us are.
Hey, you guys want to do a chant?
We know it's wrong to blaspheme the God who created us. We know it's wrong to blaspheme the God who created us, because we were created in the image of God. And the God who made us is not a blasphemer like we are. And we know all forms of sexual immorality are wrong. Whether heterosexual or homosexual, it doesn't matter. We know that because we were created in the image of God. And the God who made us is not a fornicator like so many of us are. The God who made us is not an adulterer like so many of us are. God is holy, God is righteous, and God is just. And because God is good, because God is good, God must punish sin. And the punishment God has determined for sin is eternity in hell.
Can I just say something? As a Christian, as an evangelical Christian, I know that God loves people who are LGBT.
You're lying to them, sir. You're lying to them. You're lying, sir. You're lying. See, He doesn't love you. He wants you to love Him, because love warns people when they are in danger.
How big is your dick?
Love warns people when they are in danger. Friends warn their friends when their friends are in danger. And God is good. God is holy. God is righteous. God is just. And He must punish sin, all of sin. I know, and God will punish it.
Love sin.
And God will punish sin because He's holy. And the punishment that God has determined for sin is eternity in hell.
Eternity in hell.
But the good news is this. The good news is this. Is that God has provided a way, and only one way, to escape His wrath. And that was through the gift of His Son, Jesus Christ. 2,000 years ago, God the Father sent His Son to earth in the person of Jesus Christ, truly God, truly man, and without sin. Unlike each of us, He lived a perfect life. He never sinned in thought, word, or deed like we do every day. And at a time appointed before the foundation of the world, He voluntarily went to a cross. He suffered and died a death He did not deserve, to take upon Himself the punishment we rightly deserve for our sins against God. And He forever defeated sin and death when He rose from the grave. He's alive today, and He will return at a time of the Father's choosing. And what God commands of you is the same thing He commands of me and this perverted young man and all people everywhere. Is that we repent. That we repent. That we turn from our sin. That we turn from our love of self. And by faith, and by faith alone, receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior. He will forgive your sin. He will remove it as far as the east is from the west. And He'll remember it no more. You should be shaking your head at Him. He doesn't love you. He doesn't care about you. Not if you approve of this. You're not a Christian if you approve of this. You're not a Christian if you approve of blaspheming God, of mocking the preaching of the gospel. You're not a Christian. God is a judge. I haven't judged anyone. I've called you to repent and believe. You're lying, sir. You're lying. You're lying. See, only those who love their sin and hate God would see the loving mercy of God through faith in Jesus Christ as hate. See, you know not God. You've created a God in your imagination to suit yourself. A God that's not holy. A God that's not righteous or just. Turn to Christ and live while God's given you time. He will forgive your sin. He'll forgive your sin. He'll grant you eternal life. That's a loving message.
Dude, I am fully hard right now. I'm digging it, man. Keep going.
God will not be mocked.
God will not be mocked.
You'll enjoy sin for a day, but not for eternity. When you stand before God to face his wrath, you will not be mocking him.
You will not
be laughing.
No, hey, no one laughs.
You need Christ. There's forgiveness in Christ. There's hope in Christ. There's love in Christ.
You talk a little louder.
What you're propagating here is not love.
You gotta speak louder.
It's a hatred of God. It's selfishness.
You gotta talk louder, man. I can't hear you.
So where did you come from? Hello, baby.
Davenport, Iowa.
Oh, okay. Because I saw somebody else holding the cross.
Did you really?
You.
Well, I've been here for a few hours today, yeah.
Why did you decide to come here?
Because there are people who need to hear the gospel here. Just like there is everywhere else.
Okay.
Yeah. I was at the University of Iowa on Monday. I'm usually there on Mondays. You're going to be celebrating sin.
Hella gay.
You're going to be celebrating sin.
I would like to personally thank this man for gathering such a wonderful community. Yeah. Oh, God. I love you all. Augustana loves you all. There's a God up there. God loves you all. Woo!
God bless you. Have a good day.
Thanks.
God bless you. Have a good day.
Yeah, I thought it was a good turnout, you know?
There's hope for you in Christ. The message she just gave you is not love.
No love here, folks.
God will not turn a blind eye to sin. None of it. Not mine or yours. God bless you. Have a good day. There's hope in Christ. There's peace in Christ. There's love in Jesus Christ. He is the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through him.
I'm interested to see what you think that projection of Christ's love looks like from our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm a Catholic person who also identifies as a bisexual woman. And I can recognize how from you're coming from a place of love and you're coming from a place of attempting understanding. But I just want to know what you think that love can look like for our brothers and sisters without making
Well, I haven't made the scene. I stood here quietly for 2 hours. What's your name?
Camilla.
Camilla, I'm Tony.
Nice to meet you.
Can we move just a couple of feet away so we can hear each other?
All that I want to attempt to express is that all of these people are some of the best people that I've known in my entire life. And they're emotional, and I think rightfully so, because something that they hold so near and dear to them is the integral part of their identity, is something that you're kind of, you're saying is, one gets the reason for eternal damnation, which is...
See, I haven't said that.
Yeah, no, you what? Haven't. You haven't.
Carmella, right?
Yes.
See, Carmella, the information I'm handing out says not one word about the LGBT community. I have said not one word. Yeah, this is what I'm handing out.
Sure.
It says not one word about LGBT. Not one word.
You can hold on to that, actually.
Okay? It talks about pride.
Okay.
And see, God sees pride as sin, all pride, no matter how it presents itself, whether it's LGBT pride or pride in accomplishment or pride in one's own self.
That's what I don't fully understand, I guess, is that I feel like I can be a proud woman in Christ, and I can be proud of my church, and I can be proud of my community, and I can be proud of my brothers and sisters in their accomplishments without that being outrightly sinful.
But see, not according to God's word. God says that pride leads to destruction.
Okay.
See, and what's been manifested here today is a result of that sinful pride. See, God, whether we like it or not, God sees all forms of sexual immorality as sin. No matter what letter we assign to it, whether it's heterosexual or homosexual, God is very, very specific as to what love is. And love is sacrificing of oneself for the other person's greater good.
I can agree.
Jesus,
on that.
Let me finish.
No, yes, of course.
Jesus said, greater love is no one than this, than he who lays down his life for his friends. And the reason why God sees all pride as sinful is because God himself humbled himself to take on human flesh. He humbled himself to die a death he did not deserve on a cross. And that's why God says in his word that God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. What you saw here was a manifestation of sinful pride. Now, regardless of the underlying emotion or feeling or sin that brought about the pride, what was expressed was pride. And in that expression of pride was expressed a hatred for God, a hatred for the gospel, and to a far lesser importance, a hatred for their neighbor.
Gotcha. So
okay?
I'm understanding correctly then. The issue is not in homosexuality.
Well, no,
the
look, that look, is, I'm not going to dodge that.
Okay,
because that isn't it. That, yeah. Look, that is an issue. but what this shows is that even underneath the sins of sexual immorality, even underneath the sins of lying or stealing or coveting or adultery, the sin of hatred in one's heart, underneath that is pride. And pride ultimately is a love of self.
Okay.
And a love of self is sin. Because we're to love God before ourselves. Jesus said we are to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him daily. See, true love is self-denial. True love is not self-love. True love is self-denial.
So then I guess my question would be, where is this line being drawn between self-acceptance and the ability to live with oneself and be happy and being prideful to an extent that it becomes sinful?
Because I think
that's the fundamental disconnect that's happening here, is that these people are viewing this as their expression of self and as their acceptance of the person that they are and their attempt to navigate through a world that generally tells them they shouldn't be navigating through, you know? Mm-hmm.
Well, I would disagree, Carmella, to a certain extent.
Okay.
because more now than ever in history, those who practice sexual sins, regardless of what they are applauded more now in the world than ever before. Okay?
Okay.
All right? So, look, the police did not run up here and gather all these people and take them to prison because of their expression of their identity, right?
Okay, yeah.
Okay? All right. So, the point is, to your question, you asked where the line is.
Yes.
The line is drawn by God. God has drawn.
Okay.
No, listen.
No,
God has drawn the line. See, if it's up to the individual, if it's up to us as individuals to draw the line, then that's completely arbitrary. It may be a standard you decide to live by, but it's not a standard that I have to live by. My name's Tony, by the way.
I'm Cyber.
Cyber.
It's good to meet you.
Good to meet you. And you are?
Kara.
Kara. Good to meet you. And I don't want to talk over you. I want to be very polite in my conversation with you, and I want to hear your story.
And I do too. Yeah,
okay.
Definitely.
So, it's not up to the for instance, Look, if I would assert that all four of us would agree, without knowing you ladies beyond the last 5 minutes, that all of us agree that it's wrong to take another human life with premeditation and malice aforethought. It's wrong to murder another person, right?
I think that's generally agreeable.
Yeah, okay. Now we've all asserted a truth claim, and we've all asserted morality by making that truth claim, okay?
Sure.
If it's up to the individual to determine what morality is, then no other individual can tell an individual they're wrong based on their morality. For instance, we've all established that we all agree that murder is wrong. If you three ladies came to me and said, we believe murder is wrong, and I say, well, my morality is that murder is right. If morality is truly up to the individual, you can make no assertion that I'm wrong.
So just to clarify really quick, so if this comparison being between murder and pridefulness or murder homosexuality.
No.
That's not
a comparison at all. I was just using that particular sin
as an example.
Okay. So then some would say, well, okay, it's not up to the individual. It's up to society. Society determines that what our morality is going to be. Well, we live in a country where 150 years ago, well, longer than that, 200-300 years ago, 400 years ago, we live in a country that asserted that it was right and legal to take land away from Native Americans, to subjugate them to life on reservations. And I talked to a beautiful Cherokee young lady on the campus of the University of Iowa on Monday, and she agrees her culture has never recovered from that.
But it, we can agree on that.
All right,
yeah.
Right, okay.
Definitely.
Society said it was right, it was legal to do that. More recently, our country said that it was right to consider people property because of the color of their skin, and to even consider them less than human to a certain extent. It was legal.
And
so
they used biblical.
Actually, they did not. If you truly look at genuine history, it was Christians, not only in Western Europe, but in the United States, that brought about the abolition of slavery.
I actually just took, I'm actually in a course right now, I'm going to it later, called Old Western History, and unfortunately, actually, there were a lot of Christians who did.
Well, there were people who professed to be Christians who agreed with slavery. Yes, that's true.
They justified slavery.
Right. That doesn't make God wrong. That makes those people wrong. Okay? That makes those people wrong. But there's no denying, no matter what history book you're reading, there's no denying that it was Christians who led the abolition movement, both in Western Europe and in the United States. So, and look,
I want to share something.
Okay, go ahead. Okay. Go ahead.
And I would actually appreciate, because I've been Catholic all my life, and so I'd appreciate it. Whatever you're filming doesn't go.
Well, I can't make that promise. I can't, because of the way I've been treated out here today. I don't know what's going to happen. I've been assaulted before by people who say they're loving and non-judgmental, and so I can make you no guarantees about that. I will make no promises about the video.
I promise this isn't going to be an attack on you, because I know there's photo editing. If you're going to put this on YouTube, I would very much appreciate if you just edit this out. And I just wanted to share that with you.
Well, I appreciate it. I appreciate you sharing that with me. And because I love you as my neighbor, I'm going to disagree with you. And it's not based on my standard of morality. It's not based on yours. It's not based on society's. It's based on the standard of morality that God has given each of us when he's given us a conscience and written his law in our heart. I don't know what you heard that night. I'm not going to denigrate your experience. But God, the God who created us, Cyber, would never speak to you contrary to his word.
Can I ask why you think homosexuality is wrong?
Because God says so in his word.
Where?
That's why.
So, in reference to that.
I mean, it's there in Leviticus, yes. And again, so that we don't get into this drawn out and, not to be offensive, typical conversation about eating shellfish and mixing fabrics and things like that. God gave his law to his people, and that law took different forms. There was God's moral law, which is universal and applicable to every human being throughout created history. And then there were specific laws for the Jewish people. There were dietary laws to protect their health. There were civil laws. There were sundry laws. There were other kind of laws that were for that people at that time. The dietary laws, Jesus rescinded all of them. Jesus said, there is nothing. No, I'm a Christian.
Okay.
There is nothing. Jesus said there is nothing that is unclean.
Yes. Old covenant is gone. We're not even going to talk about that right now.
Okay, all right.
So we're in agreement there. However, okay. I would like to ask you this question. A lot of
Can I finish hers first?
Yeah, of course.
Because the question was, where is that in the Bible? It's in Romans chapter 1. I'm talking about the New Testament now. And it's in 1 Corinthians 6 as well. It's in 2 Timothy 1 or 2. And the important thing to realize is that, you know, some might say, well, Jesus didn't say that. The Apostle Paul did.
Yeah.
Well, Jesus...
That's God's word.
God says about his word that all of his word is God-breathed. Jesus is the author of the entire Bible, from Genesis 1:1 through the end of Revelation. And don't forget... And don't forget, Jesus, God the Son, the second person of the triune God, is eternal. He was with the Father in creation. All things were created by him and through him and for him, according to John 1 and Colossians chapter 1. He was there when Adam and Eve were kicked out of the garden. He was there at the murder of Cain and Abel, and he was there at the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, because he's eternal. He took on human flesh 2,000 years ago when he came to earth as a person of Jesus Christ. But all of God's word is his word. And he was with the Father in creation. He's eternal. So you cannot take a part of God's word, which was penned by another person, and say, well, Jesus didn't say that. Well, of course he did. Because God inspired 40 different people over 1,500 years in three continents to pen his word.
So who's to say that voice from God is different from the voice of God that spoke to Cyber that night? Who's to say those people are
Because God says so. Because God says that his word's inspired. God does not say that the voices, and I'm not mocking you, whether audible or inaudible, God does not say that the voices in our head are true. God does not say the voices in our head are sovereign. God does not say the voices in our head are authoritative. God says his word is.
So you're referencing God says, and my understanding is you're referencing the gospel, things said in the Bible, when you say God says these things, correct?
Right,
laid out in the Bible.
Yes.
So then my question for you, maybe not so much of a question, more of just kind of amusing, I feel like reading a biblical literature has a lot to do with interpretation,
sure.
Because there are a lot of literary scholar type folks, right, who will read different parts of the Bible in a very different way. And I know we're talking specifically about the gospel, but you mentioned the book of Genesis, the creation story.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of religious scholars interpret the beginning of the book of Genesis in a different way. There are two separate creation stories laid out in the beginning of the book of Genesis.
Actually, there's not. There's the creation story in Genesis 1.
Okay.
And there's a revisiting of that same story with more specific detail in Genesis 2.
Yes.
They're not two different creation stories.
Mm-hmm.
They're the same story with emphasis on a particular aspect of creation in chapter 2 with an overall look at creation in chapter 1.
Yes.
So they're not different.
We're in agreement with that. My point in that Genesis example being that Genesis 2 is the more specific one, if I'm remembering that correctly, with a focus on different specifics of the creation story, right? But if I feel like a lot of, well, you seem very knowledgeable on the Bible and biblical literature and different texts and things, but I feel like reading different parts of the Bible can be read wildly differently depending on who you are and what your life experience
that,
is.
That's true.
So,
people
and,
do,
and I know
sure.
I'm a 19-year-old queer on the campus of a liberal arts college, right? So we're going to have wildly different life experiences. So we're going to be interpreting the Bible extremely differently. Which I think we can agree with, but...
So Carmela, if I may,
go for it.
What you're describing, the technical term for what you're describing is eisegesis. And what that means, not Jesus as in J-E-S-U-S, but E-I-S-E,
sure, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Go ahead.
So eisegesis is taking our life experience, is taking our presuppositions and imposing them upon the text of Scripture to come to an interpretation we want.
So are you claiming that you're not doing that, though?
Right,
are you claiming that the experiences of your life have no role in the way that you read and interpret
them? Well, look, I would have to say I'm a perfect human being to say that, and I'm not.
And
okay.
Yes,
but the biblical principle, the biblical principle of interpretation, though, is exegesis. It's taking God's word for what it says, and then it's interpreting, it's drawing the true meaning from the text, not imposing a meaning upon the text. Okay, so that's the difference.
I would make the argument that that's impossible to do.
Well, actually, it's not.
As humans, our human nature, I feel like, makes it nearly impossible to view from an outside perspective and not have the content of your character and the aspects of your life that you've lived through not influence your reading of the Bible. You know, so I feel.
I'm not saying that that's not certainly possible. I think, though, to say that it's impossible would require both of us to have perfect knowledge, and neither one of us do.
Yes, neither one of us do.
Okay.
On that, yes.
All right. So, more important than all of this, though, is that I love you two as my neighbors.
Well, thank you.
Okay.
I appreciate that.
And the fact that I believe what God's word says, and it contradicts what you believe about yourself, is not in and of itself hatred. I have no desire. In fact, the reason I'm here is because the absolute last thing I want for any human being, regardless of how they see themselves, regardless of the sin they practice in their life, is for them to face the wrath and judgment of God. I don't want to see anybody perish in their sin. Okay?
It's interesting that you go ahead. You mentioned wrath. I want to touch on that, but you go ahead.
But, and again, I don't want to attack here. I just want to point things out.
I appreciate the conversation.
Okay. Isn't you coming here thinking that you can change everyone an act of pride?
If I came here thinking I could change everyone, it would most definitely be an act of pride.
Why did you come here then?
Because, Cyber, I know that I can't change a single person. But I know the one who can, and that is Jesus Christ the Lord. Yes, if I came here thinking that I could change everybody's mind, that I could change not everybody. If I came here thinking that I could change one person's mind, or I could change one person's heart, then my pride would be every bit as sinful as the other pride we've seen here today. But I know that I, a mere sinful man, a human being, cannot change your mind and cannot change your heart. I know that the only one who can is Jesus Christ the Lord. And so if I love you as my neighbor, I'm going to do it whatever I can, even up to sacrificing my own life, to share the good news of the gospel with you, with the hope that Jesus will change your mind.
We're going to have to disagree there, because I know that God has cemented who I am. He created me as I am.
My name is Natalie. I'm from the Observe. I'm school news.
Hi, Natalie.
Would you guys all be?
Well, I really don't, I don't mean to be rude or disrespectful, but I really want to continue this conversation, and please stay, and if you have time, I'll go right ahead. I am. Go right ahead. Yeah.
I actually have to get going to class, but I would like to, one final thing. You mentioned wanting to protect your brothers and sisters in Christ from the wrath of God, right?
Let me explain what I said. I'm not protecting my brothers and sisters in Christ from the wrath of God, because those who are in Christ are not under the wrath of God. Okay?
All right.
God is a wrathful God. God has said in his word that he will punish the wicked. He says that the soul that sins shall die. And what makes God's love so extraordinary is that he would send and sacrifice his own son to die for people like me, who deserve nothing but his wrath because I've broken his law and I've sinned against him.
But that's the point, isn't it? God isn't a wrathful God anymore. We don't deserve wrath because Jesus died on the cross.
God hasn't changed. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And again, Jesus was with the Father in creation. And God has given to Jesus the power to judge. And he will. He came as a meek and mild baby. He was born under the most humblest of circumstances in existence. But when he came that way to die on behalf of sinners like us. But when he returns, he's not going to come as a baby. He's going to come as a wrath-filled lion of the tribe of Judah to judge both the living and the dead.
How do you know?
Because that's what his word tells us. That's what his word promises us.
It doesn't say he's going to come in wrath. It says
he's
going to come in light.
No. Well, you need
light and glory and love.
It does not say that.
Okay, yeah. Right before I leave, I just want to get this last word in. I choose to live my life believing that God is the God of love, and that in all of our human manifestations of sin, including pride and including homosexuality for going that direction, and including lying and all of the sins, I choose to believe in a God that is forgiving and is loving.
Yes.
And gives us the opportunity to have a dialogue this with our fundamental disagreements and have it still be a positive, formative thing. So I hope you're leaving this conversation with us both having maybe a couple tidbits of new thoughts that we maybe hadn't considered before. I know you seem very steadfast in your beliefs, and I know that would
right.
be
Right, yeah, and what frightens me for you, Carmela, is that you've created a God in your imagination to suit yourself. A God who's going to turn a blind eye to sin. But he's not. He's holy. He's righteous. He's just.
Okay.
And our forgiveness is not in the fact that we accept ourselves and we accept our sin. Our forgiveness,
I think it's
our
in the fact that God accepts me.
But God, but God's word doesn't say that. God's word doesn't say that he accepts us.
I thought we were in similar pages before.
Well, no, he doesn't.
Did you want to?
God loves his son.
I just had a question, if I may. As a Christian who has gone through seminary and studied the scriptures and who believes the scriptures completely, why, if you believe that homosexuality is a sin, why is that sin worse than all the other?
I've never said that. That's a straw man. I'm sorry, my name's Tony.
Tony, good to meet you.
And you are?
Oops,
sorry, Chief. I'm sorry, what was your first name?
Lucas,
okay. Yes. Lucas, I never once asserted that one sin was worse than another. So to assign that thought to me is a straw man. I'm not, actually. I have not, until this crowd arrived and began to mock God and blaspheme God and do other things.
By having a different view?
No. Okay, Lucas, if we're going to have a conversation, it's got to be honest. Okay.
Absolutely.
All right. And there was a man here pretending to have an orgasm here with God on the ground. Okay. So I don't know what seminary you went to. All right. But that's blasphemous. Okay. I never brought up Lucas.
I was just going to respond to that, if I may. The book Song of Solomon in the Bible implies that God's people are his lovers.
Yeah, but to equate a perverted man acting like he's having an orgasm on the ground to the Song of Solomon, in and of itself, is blasphemous, Lucas.
I would call someone perverted without knowing him.
Well, Lucas, maybe you weren't here, but I was watching it, Lucas. So, Lucas, here's the point. Here's the point, Lucas. Here's the point. God does say that all forms of sexual immorality are sin, regardless of how we define it, regardless of what letter we assign to it. God's word says that all sexual immorality is sin. God says that lying is a sin, that stealing is a sin, that blasphemy is a sin, that coveting is a sin, that harboring bitterness, resentment, or hatred in our heart for a human being for any reason is a sin.
Yeah, Jesus in fact said that whoever gets divorced, right, is committing adultery. Right? We don't ever
Well, remember now remember, divorce. Remember.
The church has made room for people.
Remember Lucas that Jesus wrote the entire Bible. That Jesus is the author of the entire Bible, that he was with the Father in creation, that he is the author and perfecter of the Christian faith, that he is the Word who became flesh. Okay, God hates divorce. Okay, Jesus never said that he was okay with divorce. In fact, the Pharisees asked him, you know, why is it then that Moses allowed for a certificate of divorce? And he said, because your hearts were hard. Right. And there is forgiveness for the sin of divorce. There is forgiveness for the sin of adultery. There is forgiveness for lying and coveting. There is forgiveness for sexual immorality, but it is only through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ.
So is it human's job? So I've read in the Bible that it's the Holy Spirit who draws people to repentance. Is it Christian's job to accuse other people?
I haven't accused anybody of anything. So please, I'm going to call you on every straw man you offer. I'm going to call you, Lucas, on every straw man you offer. Okay, I haven't accused anybody of anything. God is a God of means.
Everyone of pride.
No, I said pride was sin.
And you said everyone here was prideful.
I said pride is sin. That's what I said.
But you and said I called everyone people here, this is a display of pride.
Well, it was a display of pride. Certainly, yeah.
So you're saying these people are prideful, so you're accusing them of pride, which is a sin.
Pride is a sin, yes.
Yes, and you accuse these people.
Yes, I saw it. I saw it with my own eyes.
But you just said you weren't accusing people.
If you stole my backpack, and I accuse you of stealing my backpack, yes, I'd be accusing you of stealing my backpack.
Okay, but you weren't accusing anybody of sin. You weren't accusing anybody of anyone. I just wanted to...
So while you call him out for two things,
we're going to call you
out. Okay, that's fine. Okay, great. Okay. So, so Lucas, God is the author of his word. He calls all to repentance and faith, and he is a God, and he is a God of means. Romans 14, 10 to 17 says that how will they hear without a preacher? And it says in Romans 1, Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation. God uses the proclamation of the gospel, whether verbally or in written form,
or in creation, which is what that's actually talking about in Romans.
That begins in verse 18. That begins in verse 18, but he's very specific in verses 16 and 17 that it is the gospel that is the power of God for salvation. And yes, people know that God, every human being knows that God exists because creation testifies to it, okay? But it is through the proclamation of the gospel that someone comes to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And it is the Spirit at work on that person as they're hearing the proclamation of the gospel that they will repent and believe.
And gospel means good news.
That's right.
Good news is a proclamation that God is love, that God will and is reconciling all creation to himself.
Not everybody is going to heaven, Lucas.
I'm not talking about heaven. I'm talking about reconciliation.
Okay, well, but reconciliation. But reconciliation with God only comes through faith in Jesus Christ. Only through faith in Jesus Christ.
So,
and God is love, but he's not a God of love in contradiction to his holiness and his righteousness and his judgment and his wrath. He is equally all those things perfectly at the same time.
Yes, so the fruit of talk, the fruit of this sort of, you know, singling out people and accusing them is...
I haven't singled anybody out, Lucas.
People who are LGBT thinking that the church has nothing to offer.
Lucas, do you know how
the idea is that
Lucas, I didn't single anybody out.
Of me as a person. And so the fruit of that, if you want younger people who are LGBT to join the church, this is not the way to go about it.
Well, Lucas, the way to go about it is to speak the truth in love.
And the truth in love is that God is love.
Yeah, but God
Jesus is radical.
Right, and he will not turn a blind eye to sin, Lucas. He's not going to turn a blind eye to sin. And I am loving you, Lucas, because I'm telling you the truth. That the God you apparently worship is a God you've created in your own imagination to suit yourself. One who's going to approve your sin and love your sin. And that is not the God of the Bible. That is not the Jesus. Yes, but Lucas has to repent of his sin and put his trust and his faith in Christ alone to receive that forgiveness. God is not going to arbitrarily forgive anyone's sin, just like a judge in a courtroom isn't going to arbitrarily let convicted criminals go. You know, if I'm arrested for breaking the law and I say to the judge, I believe you're a loving, giving, and benevolent judge, and I think you ought to let me go, no judge, no good judge is going to let me go on the basis of that. I'm making that comparison because God is the ultimate judge.
Yes, he's the ultimate judge, and there's also Jesus. But you've been saying like God is above us.
He is.
Why are you comparing them to men? If we're below him, why?
Why am I?
Why are you comparing Jesus to men if he's above us?
Because he is the standard. Let me answer your question. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, "You are to be perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect."
True. So
God's standard. God's.
Judging stuff. Who says that's not the way it is?
God does.
Yeah.
God has in his word. See, we are not the arbiter. Well, sure. What, that he is the judge?
No.
There is
exactly. He judges. Can you cite in the Bible?
Yeah, I can.
Or is this another way to manipulate the Bible? So
well, no, it's not a, no, it's not a way. It's not a way to manipulate the Bible. God has said in his word that he will judge both the living and the dead. He has said he has given... Yes.
Us.
Right. Oh, right. Yeah. I can no more send you to heaven than I can send you to hell. And I have no desire whatsoever for any human being to perish in their sin.
No, but you could definitely tell people that they're going to hell, and you have done that.
Yeah, sure, because I love them. Look, yeah. I haven't.
It is so backwards.
No, it's not. It's not. Look. If I look, it's not. Look, and you just blasphemed him.
Whatever.
Oh, I know. Whatever. Okay. So. Look, it's loving to warn people when they're in danger. Friends warn their friends when their friends are in danger.
How are they putting themselves in danger?
Because they're sinning against the God they know. And God is good, and he's going to punish all sin, the sin we love to commit and the sin we hypocritically commit and point out in others and judge them. God is going to judge all sin because he's good, because he's holy and righteous and just. And the only way of escape from his just and his holy wrath is through the loving gift of his son, Jesus Christ. Through faith and repentance in Jesus Christ and him alone. God will not turn a blind eye to his sin, to any sin. God is not going to turn a blind eye to the definition of love that Lucas has and so many others have created for themselves. God's not going to turn a blind eye to the blaspheming of God by creating a God in our imagination who's going to accept our sin and who's going to say that God is all love while ignoring every other aspect of his character.
If I may, because you said We're throwing Leviticus aside. You weren't going
to... I'm not throwing it aside because it's God's word. Why would I throw it aside? I explained to you...
Get into the typical argument.
No, we can't get into the typical argument if we understand how the law was presented in Leviticus.
Why is that different than the shellfish and the...
As I explained, there were aspects of the law that God gave to Israel that was specific for the people of Israel. God also gave his moral law, the law that he has written on each of our hearts and giving us a conscience that is universal and applicable to every human being in every age.
But who's to say the shellfish isn't the moral one and it's the man that likes
Jesus? Jesus said so. Jesus said...
Jesus addressed homosexuality at all.
Well, that wasn't her question. We were talking about the shellfish.
I'm happy to yield the floor.
Yeah,
yeah.
Jesus never mentioned homosexuality.
Yes, he did. Jesus did. He most certainly did because he said marriage is between a man and a woman. Yes, he did.
I know what you're thinking.
That Jesus, okay.
For this reason, a man will be united to his... No.
Right. No, it's not. Jesus affirmed marriage between one man and one woman. And Jesus also spoke in Romans 1 and 1 Corinthians 6 and everywhere else homosexuality is mentioned in the Bible. Right, and Jesus is the author of his word. It was Jesus who inspired 40 different men over 1,500 years and 3 continents to pen his word. Jesus is the... I'm sorry?
1,500 years.
Over 1,500 years. That's the span of time it took to write the word of God. Yes.
I don't know. Just looking at the way men have acted, we've had so many wars and stuff. We've had so much corruption. Hell, Chicago is a windy city. Who says there hasn't been corruption in the Bible?
You won't find it. You won't find it. We have.
I know why.
Well, you don't.
I do.
Okay. Well, what is your
because
example?
It was a human error. It was the misprint in the Bible. That's why people think that the fruit, the forbidden fruit, was an apple because they actually printed the wrong word.
That might be in the King James Version, but an apple is still a piece of fruit. If you look at the Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic texts that we have. That date back thousands of years before the New Testament. The New Testament dating back within a generation of its writing. The only discrepancies you will find, the typographical errors that you will find, are grammatical. There is nothing that touches the theology of the Word of God.
True, but that was a number of years to personally be able to say it hasn't been edited, it hasn't been put in different words.
Well, you know, we have the internet, so you can go and look at the ancient manuscripts, you can go look at the text, and you can look at the English translations.
So for instance,
we're not talking about interpretation right now.
Interpretation is important because your interpretation alone does not determine it for everybody. So for instance, when it comes to that cited passage of, you know, man cannot lie with man, scholars have interpreted that as, you know, condemning pedophilia, for instance, you know? So basically what you're doing here, you're not getting through to people because you're just insisting that you're
well, no, I'm,
alone.
Look, my name's Tony. What's yours?
My name is Shayna.
Hi, Shayna. Shayna or Shayna?
Shayna.
Well, Shayna, the reason I'm not getting...
Let her finish, please.
The reason I'm not getting through to people It's because the Spirit of God isn't letting it get through to people. That's why. I haven't hated any. Can you tell me what I've said that was hateful?
You're basically saying, you, for instance, you've called somebody here who is protesting what you're saying perverted, a perverted young person.
Because yeah, the guy who was pretending to have an orgasm while he was lying on the ground is perverted. Yes, it was. It was.
That you're condemning it was. Homosexuality, you're handing out hateful pamphlets. You're
that's a lie. Shayna, that's a lie. Do you know what I'm handing out?
It's a lie that homosexuality is wrong.
Yeah, I would like to see what
yeah, let's see what we're handing out. Can I?
You will not see any mention whatsoever about the LGBT community. Anywhere? No, it doesn't. It has multiple colors, and God formed the rainbow. Right? Pride is a sin.
I just
all pride is a sin. Your pride, my pride, all pride is a sin.
Minority position within Christianity.
Isn't this pride though? What you're doing?
No, I'm trying to love you as my neighbor. Trying to bring you to a knowledge of the truth.
But wait, the words you're speaking are the reason why my aunts could not marry for 20 plus years because it was not accepted. They can't. People, you cannot change your sexual orientation.
Well, your aunts aren't married.
They're married.
Not in the eyes of God. They're not married. Maybe in the eyes of the state.
Separation
maybe in the eyes
of church and state.
Oh, whatever.
And
but
we talked about
but they're not married in the eyes of God.
You've said something about how marriage is between a man and a woman.
Right. That's what God says.
I'm in a constitutional law class. The definition of marriage has evolved with our society.
Irrelevant.
The doctrine of coverture bound men and women as one entity because women were subservient.
Yeah.
If you're talking about thousands of years of history, women were considered subservient to men, just one entity, not having the ability to have their own property, for instance, not being able to wear pants, for instance. Our society changes. So for you to say this is the definition of marriage, you're one of many interpretations.
Yeah, God has defined marriage. The Constitution
the
does
state,
not. The government doesn't. God has.
But
God has. God has
that
defined
is just
it.
That's just one single belief. There are many religions. It's, how is yours correct? How is yours the only correct belief here?
Because God has said so in His Word.
But what about the other scriptures and other religious
yeah,
texts?
Yeah, they're wrong.
Why?
Because they contradict
you're
the Word of God.
You're just one human being.
They contradict
if
the Word of God.
There is a God. He is
there
incomprehensible.
Is a God. You know, no, you, that's not true. That's not true.
Okay,
it's not true that
I'm
God
saying,
is incomprehensible.
Are you saying your word is above that of
no,
whatever?
I'm saying God's word is above
okay,
all.
Okay, then you don't have the right to speak on that because...
I do. Sure I do.
But why can't other people speak on
that? I haven't stopped anyone from speaking.
But you're saying everyone's wrong except you.
No, I'm saying everyone's wrong but God. Everyone's
sorry.
Wrong. Pardon me.
You're not God. You're not speaking you're on behalf of God.
I am. I've opened His word. I've preached His word.
Everybody
I'm preaching His gospel.
Everybody else has introduced their interpretations, which is to love and accept people around us. We're all not the same. You cannot say...
yes, I can.
As one person, that homosexuality is wrong.
I can, because God's word says it is.
But that's your interpretation, and we can talk
that's
about
not my day. Interpretation. That's what He says. That's what He says
have
in
you
His
spoken
word.
To him?
Yeah, he's spoken to me through His word. His
what's
word.
His
he's
word?
Given the Bible.
And as
the Bible.
We've indicated, it has had
you have
at
not
least one mistake.
Yeah, you have not indicated any mistakes in the Bible.
I did with the
fruit.
Apple.
Yeah. And if you're
that's,
saying
that's
you
it's a
say
piece of fruit. It doesn't affect
it
the theology of God's
it
word.
That's not
right. And if you look at some of the other translations, they indicate that and right. Yes,
so
translations from the original texts.
If
yeah.
you take a text and you edit it and you translate it and you edit it, even just
you don't have any evidence of that, though.
You don't have evidence of your singular interpretation.
Yeah, I have the Word of God.
But
you know that there's like thousands of other texts that were not put in the Bible because
but the Nicene Council put together.
That's not true. That's not true. The Nicene Council did not put together. No, it's not. See, no, it's not. The Nicene Council did not put together the Bible. They merely affirmed and codified what had already been believed by the church since the days of Christ. Thousands of years. No, the Nicene Council was in the 4th century. That wasn't thousands of years after the apostles
okay.
were dead.
Okay,
but the church had already believed that. They had already. They always believed that.
But we're also men. We twist our words so we gain what we want.
Okay, so. Anyways, the bottom, because I am going to have to go, the bottom line is that there is hope in Christ. That there is forgiveness for sin in Christ. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. There is no other way. They're not Christians.
You're not the only
they're
person
not Christians.
You cannot
any,
say that.
Anyone it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you were confirmed.
You
confirmation
God,
doesn't make you a Christian. You're only a Christian if you were
God
born again.
If you didn't realize that. He loves everybody.
Yeah, and he also and he also hates those who break
why
his law.
Hate
and
you,
that's not true. Read Proveriges chapter 6. Yes, it does.
Sorry.
Like, I'm very passionate.
You're right.
Yelling isn't gonna get anywhere.
there.
And he does have to go. All we can really understand is that that Jesus can forgive him for being turning a blind eye to some of his word. And to most of his beliefs as well.
We're in an evolving society, that's all I'll say. We're never going back.
We're a devolving society.
We're not going back.
We are a devolving society. We love, because we love sin more now than we ever have. All right, so if you'll listen, I'm going to answer the question about whether or not God hates.
Sure.
Okay? Now remember, God's character is perfect. His love is perfect. His hatred is perfect. His wrath is perfect. His mercy and his grace.
Read the book.
No, I'm going to finish what I'm saying, young man. Have some respect.
God's word is way more important.
He'll get to the book faster if we let him just...
Listen. God is perfect. God's hatred isn't like our hatred. Our hatred is sinful because our hatred is selfish. And God commands us not to hate, not to hate anyone for any reason. Okay? But God does hate. He doesn't merely hate the sin. Listen, Proverbs chapter 6, there are six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. A heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, and one who sows discord among brothers. Now, if you were listening, he doesn't merely hate being haughty. He hates the one who has haughty eyes. He doesn't merely hate telling lies. He hates a lying tongue. He doesn't merely hate the shedding of innocent blood. He hates the one who sheds innocent blood. And again, the point of this is that this is what makes God's love and grace and mercy so amazing, because he extends it to people, human beings like us, who deserve nothing but his wrath against our against sin. One moment. Against sin. God, see, I know God loves me, but it's not because of who I am. It's in spite of who I am that God loves me.
Are you saying that God doesn't love me?
I don't know. I don't know. I know that God hates and loves at the same time and perfectly. Look, God promises to punish sinners, but he also promises to forgive sinners. And the only way God could do that is if God himself paid the punishment for sinners like us. Look, if I was in a courtroom and I was convicted of a crime and I was sentenced to death, and let's take all of the arguments away, I did it, I confessed, the evidence was there. It wasn't a case of mistaken identity, it wasn't a corrupt police officer, it wasn't a corrupt judicial system. I committed the crime, I was guilty. And the judge sentenced me to death. And he says, Mr. Miano, you're not going to get 20 years of meals and beds and free education and 20 years of appeals on the taxpayer's dime. We're going to take you into the next room right now. We're going to strap you to a gurney and we're going to put you to sleep like a stray dog. And just as they're about to do that, the judge stands up from behind his bench. He takes off his robe of authority. He steps down from his bench and says, Tony, you're guilty. You deserve to die, and I'm going to take your place. The requirements of the law have to be satisfied, but I'm not going to make you satisfy that. I'm going to satisfy it on your behalf. And my friends, that's exactly what Jesus Christ did on the cross. It is at the cross where justice and mercy kissed. It is the only way the God who promises to punish sinners can reconcile, without being an eternal contradiction, the fact that he loves sinners and he saves them. It was at the cross. It's where justice and mercy kissed, where God the Father made his Son, Jesus Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin on our behalf, so that through him we might receive the righteousness of God.
If sin is forgiven, we're all sinners. Isn't there a passage that says you're not to be the first? I know some other people know it better than me. Throwing the first stone when you yourself sin?
Right, okay, you're referring to John chapter 8.
You must remove the beam from your own eye.
And you're removing and you're referring to Matthew 7. Matthew 7:1 says, "Judge not lest you be judged." It is the most popular verse among unbelievers in the world today. And they don't bother to read the rest of the verses, okay? Matthew chapter 7.
I actually have a question on that last verse. I might have misheard the end of it. What was that about turning brother against brother?
And isn't hate selfish when it comes from humans?
I'm sorry?
Isn't hate selfish when it comes from humans?
Of course,
and
yeah.
And it's a sin that, to turn brother against brother?
Yeah, to sow discord among brothers. Right. Yeah. Right. Okay. But again, we can't pull verses out of their context. Scripture interprets scripture, right? And while it says not to sow discord among brothers, it also says to love your neighbor as yourself. And that's what I'm doing. I'm trying to love you as my neighbor because 30 years ago, someone took me aside, a very proud, arrogant, hateful people. I hated people because of the color of their skin. I did. All right. No, I don't. Of course, no, I don't. I don't hate them for their sexual orientation.
Sean's been waiting
patiently. I don't hate them for their sexual orientation. Look. 30 years ago, someone pulled me aside and showed me that I wasn't a good person, that I was a sinner before God, that if I died at that moment and stood before God, wearing a badge and a gun as a deputy sheriff wouldn't save me. Going to church on Sunday wouldn't save me. Being baptized or confirmed into the church wouldn't save me. My sin condemned me before God. I needed Christ. And someone loved me as their neighbor enough to share the law and the gospel with me, and I'm trying to love you the same way. It's not with hatred that I come to you with this message. It's not with hatred for the LGBT community or the person committed to death row that I come with this message. It's the desire that every human being would come to repentance and faith in Christ, that everyone would experience the true love of God. Not the sinful love that we create in our imagination and assign to God, but the true love of God. Jesus said, greater love is no one than this, than he who lays down his life for his friends. And that's what Jesus did. But he not only laid down his life for his friends, he laid down his life for his enemies. On the cross, he said, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. A man who was nailed to a cross next to him mocked him as he himself was dying. But by the Spirit of God, he was brought to repentance, and Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. That's good news. That's good news.
So how do we reconcile that it's a sin to bring discord between brothers? How do we reconcile? Oh, wow.
Thank you.
How do we reconcile that with Matthew 10, 34 through 36, where Jesus said, do not think that I have come to bring peace.
Right, but a sword.
A sword.
Right.
And I come to turn mother against
right.
daughter,
yeah.
mother-in-law against
yeah.
daughter-in-law,
sure.
father against son.
Yeah.
That awfully seems like Jesus himself is bringing discord between
No, it's not at all.
It's not,
and it's not a contradiction either, because Jesus said, the world will hate you because of me. Remember why they killed Jesus. Remember why they killed Jesus. They didn't kill Jesus for hanging out with sinners. They didn't kill Jesus for eating with tax collectors. They didn't kill Jesus for touching the unclean, those who had diseases like leprosy. They didn't kill Jesus because he talked to women, which was forbidden in society. They didn't kill Jesus for the things he did. They killed Jesus for what he said. And he said, I and the Father are one. And he said, before Abraham was, I am. And he said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. And he said, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me. They killed him for what he said.
But that doesn't answer my question.
It does.
For being who they are because of these beliefs. Gay people are killed, trans people are killed because their families can't accept them, their communities don't accept them because of stuff like this.
Because of stuff like what? Not because of the gospel.
You're condemning people.
I haven't condemned you. See, you're not listening.
Then what is
you're not listening.
I have heard you loud.
We need to get over. He's trying.
You're not listening. Look, if you were listening, look.
I would like to say something just really quickly.
Okay.
If you're talking about sin and you're wanting to assist people from being free of sin, how come you're only picking homosexuality.
Okay, so let's go.
Do you eat shrimp? Do you wear mixed fabrics?
Okay, so we'll do this again. We'll do this again. We'll do this again simply because you weren't here when these conversations happened. But I'll do this again for your own edification. Okay? Let me answer your question.
But the thing
please.
Is, you choose to answer a question, then you keep going without.
Well, because answers aren't yes and no. I'm not going to be pigeonholed into a yes or no answer to fit your narrative.
It's not. But you're
okay?
the one who's kind of twisting a narrative to ultimately bring it back to your single interpretation.
It's not
what you think God is, who you think God is.
Can I answer your question?
I'm about to leave here because
okay.
you're not here to reach people. You're here to push what you is.
You're
your
lying
singular,
to yourself.
You're
lying to
me.
Yourself.
I'm not lying to myself. I recognize what love is. I see love and goodness in our community here, and all you are doing is condemning people for who they are. You're not reaching anybody here. You're preaching hatred.
That's a lie.
There are so many people who abandoned their children for being LGBT. My aunt was called an abomination by her mother due to this religious faith. What about love your neighbor, respect your neighbor? All these things that the Bible preaches about love, this isn't love. You are not to say what God wants. It's incomprehensible what God wants.
That's
you
not true.
You can't take a religious text that has been around for thousands and thousands of years, apply your single interpretation to it, and expect a society to follow your single view.
I don't expect society to follow my views.
Then what are you doing here with us?
I'm loving you with the truth of the gospel.
I don't feel love. It's fear.
I can't control that.
You're afraid.
I'm not afraid.
You're afraid.
Of what? What am I afraid of?
You're afraid that if you don't
I'm surrounded by
it,
people who don't like me. What am I afraid of?
I dislike you. I dislike what you're saying. What you're saying threatens people I love. My roommate, my aunts who finally were able to marry. This narrative changes our society.
Society does change.
Our society changes, and we're loving and accepting people in the LGBT community, and we cannot go back.
Can I say something?
Yes.
I also agree that the Bible is God's word, the one who created us. And it's everyone's choice to believe or not. And he believes the Bible, and so do I. And it's our responsibility, because we've been there. We've been blinded. We've been deceived. We're not judging anybody. We are loving because God told us to. He told us to warn, because he will come back, and there will be a judgment day. And if we aren't, your blood will be on our hands if we say nothing. If we stand by and say,
but isn't that our personal choice?
It is, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Then why does it matter?
Why does it matter? Why is it homosexuality?
Why are you arguing? Why are you talking to him?
Because
it matters.
I think you're seeking. Yeah. I think you're seeking the truth.
I'm seeking the truth that we should accept and love people as they are. If we're talking about sin, why is he specifically here handing out these about...
There's not one word on there about the LGBT community.
My sin?
This is a dog whistle,
dude. Anybody's sin. It's gossip.
It's pride. It's about pride.
It's hatred. It's anything. It's not.
But then why is he here saying, condemning...
I haven't condemned anybody.
Why are you trying to say that it is God's word that people should not be gay? That's what's happening here. You're not condemning sin in general. That'd be different. You're looking...
Before you leave, because you said you were going to leave, and I want you to stay as long as you want to, okay? I'm not trying to chase you away at all. But I have to say this. I stood here for 2 hours. I had a few nice conversations with people. I handed out tracts. I didn't say one word about the LGBT community. I didn't say anything about the LGBT community. The tract that I've been handing out deals with the specific sin of pride.
But why is there an LGBT flag on it?
It's not an LGBT flag. Look at it. That is not an LGBT flag. That is not an LGBT flag.
But
the rainbow. The rainbow symbolizes God's promise never to again punish the earth by flood. That's
what does that have to do with pride? Like, there's the rainbow.
It's God's promise. God's promise of forgiveness.
That can either be attributed to God's promise, or that can be attributed to the LGBT community.
Right. The LGBT community doesn't own the word pride, and they don't own the word rainbow.
But you took two unconnected things.
They're not unconnected.
No.
Because God killed the entire world because of pride.
Pride and the rainbow.
God killed every human being but 8 people because of pride.
If we all have a private personal relationship with God, and you said sin can be forgiven, why are you here to tell people?
Because sin can only be forgiven through faith in Jesus Christ and him alone.
What about other religions?
faith can only, forgiveness is only through Christ.
That is your belief. No, that's what I'm trying to say.
That is what Jesus said. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth. I am one person.
Interpretation.
Jesus said,
you're not going to acknowledge that your interpretation is one amongst many, even within you.
Jesus said, I am the way and the truth. And listen, Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. Okay, who's interrupting now? Do you want to? Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Interpret that.
You're here to talk at people. You're here to specifically hand out these cards, and you know the connotation. You can't say you do not know the connotation.
Yeah.
Like I said, I'm going to leave, but I just wanted to say to you, I hope you can someday accept that people are who they are.
I do.
Society can come to a point where we
and every human being needs Christ.
Equality. We accept that gay, LGBT.
There is only marriage between man and woman.
Same rights. God. Uncontested.
God has determined the definition
of
marriage.
Do not have to have this argument any further.
God.
So I'm going to go. Now.
Okay. Bye bye. Nice talking to you.
I'm still confused about how it's not contradictory. Like, specifically, it's a sin to bring discord between brothers, and I have come to bring war between family members. Like, without getting into the context of Jesus' sacrifice, how are those non-contradictory?
Well, you can't remove the context of Jesus.
That's exactly how you logic can't, works.
You can't have logic without God. That's a whole other conversation.
A equals A regardless of what A is.
Right, but I'm not going to...
If A then B.
Right, but I am
a
not...
A exists implies B exists regardless of the context.
I am not going to remove the context of Jesus' sacrifice.
I mean, it should
because
just be
everything he said
equation.
Pointed to that ultimate
a
sacrifice.
A logical equation should get us.
GSA resource sheet?
All right. Well, I do have to be going. I do have to be going, but I'll probably be back next Wednesday. This has been wonderful. I hope to see many of you again.
We hope to see you again.
Good. What's your name?
Noah.
Noah?
Yes.
Nice
like
name.
Like in the Bible, right?
Nice name.
Yeah.
Ma'am? Ma'am? Do you have a minute?
I feel like you would have an easier time getting your message across about God's love if you didn't put pride in the rainbow flag.
Well, but pride is a sin. All forms are.
Yeah,
so,
I just think you could have a better chance of getting your message across on our campus.
I appreciate your input. Thank you.